Hey everybody, can you hear me? Anybody there on the chat, can you hear me? On the voice channel? Anybody? Yeah, I'm a doof. Thanks for that. Yeah, I mean, thank you. I was muted because I'm a dumb. Let's see, where are we at? All right, you can all hear me now, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Wow, good timing, Dr. K. Very good timing.
I'm trying to turn over a new leaf.
Yeah, you're doing good.
You know, even a clock's right twice a day, right? I mean, I gotta
a stop clock twice.
Right. Yeah, stop clock, right, is right twice a day. I gotta occasionally luck into it, you know.
There you go.
So yeah, I don't know. There's always I gotta remember the dumb mute. Thanks, Mike, for that heads up. Let me just do. I gotta just do a quick volume adjust on that. We're good. All right. Okay. Let's. Hey, everybody. How's everybody doing? Fantastic. I hope. Let me see. I am jumping into pulling. Yeah. Check that out. I mean, this is unreal, right? It's like 102. And we are in slide mode. Holy crap.
Wait, gotta check YouTube.
I know YouTube is rolling. I haven't actually checked it for the audio. Hold on a second. Unless somebody's already there and...
I'm doing it right now.
Okay, awesome.
Oh, it's good.
And you got students on there as well?
Yep.
Awesome. And then... I'm just going to throw this link over in the chat just so everyone's got it. Ba-boom. Okay, and then I'll also throw that into the... I'm not going to do it right now, but I will throw that into the schedule on Canvas. Trying to pump all the link, you know, all the links for all the lectures as we do them, dropping them in there so that becomes easy for everybody if you either want to review or you've got, you know what I mean, you're just not here at class time because you've got other schedule stuff, which is probably the majority are in that situation. So, okay, let me see. Just making a note. Okay, something that keeps coming up on chat stuff. Let me just hit you with a couple of reminders. Okay, reminder number one, please hit me up on Discord if you have issues, questions, and please, if you can avoid it, don't email me on the Canvas inbox or on my, I mean, you can, but it's just... the Canvas thing, the interface is clunky enough that it's just problematic enough for me. And there's a couple of like weird danger zones. Like if you're typing a response, maybe you guys have done this, and then you accidentally hit escape, boom, gone, just vanishes. Like you're writing War and Peace, and all of a sudden it just poof, gone. No draft, no nothing. brutal. So that is just such a big emotional scar for me. And relative to my going to like my UVU email address, the danger there is I've got an unspeakable amount of emails in my inbox. So there's a, don't even start, Zach. Do not even start. But oh, I'm not taking the bait. I am not going to take the bait on that. But no, I have so many, it's just easy to be just accidentally dropped into my email compost pile. That's the danger zone of dropping into my UVU email. But if you just hit me up on Discord, I've got the list of, you know, it gives me the sort of the notifications of everybody that's hit me up with a DM. So that's sort of big number one. So please, you know, hit me up that way. Number two, the other question we're getting a lot of, I'm getting, I think, a fair amount of, is can I look at my homework? Can I look, you know, how, can I get the homework graded? Yeah, what we prefer to do on the homework grading is actually get one-on-one with you. So the best way to do that is to, there's on the schedule on Canvas. Let me show you really quick what I'm talking about. Boom, boom, boom. Okay, here we go. So here is, I know this is not readable and it's okay, that's not really the point. The point is, boom, that's the point right there. Okay, so this is just the syllabus, right? And blah, blah stuff, blah, blah, class schedule, notes about how we're doing class. And then right here, testing lobby hours. So as a reminder to everybody watching on YouTube, there are still some who have not been on Discord. So reminder number one, the testing lobby is right here on Discord. The invite is right up here somewhere, right there. That should be an invite that does not expire. If it has expired, I need to know, but it wasn't supposed to expire. So that just gives you access to where we are right now on Discord. And then this is schedules for stuff, who's got hours when. So you can kind of see the ones where it's emptied out, it's sort of like it was just tough to get. Anyway, our schedules just didn't collide, but that's quite a bit of coverage. And really all of us, if you can catch us off times, you know, in the evenings, weekends, whatever, if you can catch us and we're available, we're more than happy to sit down with you, okay? Class is right here. And that's usually just kind of means, you know, I'm not available. Although Zach is usually in class dropping, snarky, provocative memes. And therefore, if there was something going on that you had to pull Zach away for, you could do that. But ideally you're both here. And then I try to, I guess that just goes until 2:15. And then I try to hang around and then Vlad shows up about 3:00. So, and then I am on squad at 8 a.m. I strategically chose those times because I knew that basically none of you are going to be up at that hour. And if you are up at that hour, it's because you're still up at that hour. Am I right? So that was strategic on my part. But on the other hand, I'm probably the one most likely to help you at 1 a.m. So it kind of balances out. Okay. But as I said, DM us. Okay. And then similarly, some of you have asked, how do I see like what I got, you know, what I missed on the exam, on the module exams? Same thing. Okay. It's the very same thing. Hit us up. We'll do it. We'll try to jump to direct message. You know what I mean? So we'll try not to, you know, walk through your exam, you know, in the general channel, you know what I mean? In the text channel. And so it's kind of nice. You can jump on, we can jump on voice chat, jump on video chat, share screen, super handy to jump on DM with whoever's on duty. Okay. All right. Are there any, you guys have any other logistical questions? at all about the Highway to the Danger Zone or anything else for that matter? Anybody? Bueller? Come on, man. Give me something. Give me some love. Give me some yay, nay. Wait, what was that?
Danger Zone.
Danger Zone. Okay, actually, can I get somebody to... Believe it or not, I actually want to try and experiment, okay? And we're going to get into bits, but this is actually important. There are a number of phases during class where I have videos and, you know, video or audio or things like that. And the problem is, and I've spent hours trying to debug this thing, even with smart undergrad TAs and such. And basically, when you stream to Discord and you're on a Mac, you cannot stream the audio. So you're screwed on the audio. And then the whole thing, I've got the headphones, the whole thing is tied up in taking all the sound that comes into me and funneling it out the YouTube channel, right? So that's how when you guys make sounds, like a really feeble attempt at singing the chorus to Highway to the Danger Zone. No offense. I'm sure that you could uncork if we weren't in this constrained environment. All that sound funnels, so including student sounds. So I think I may have a solution. So I would like to, and I think we should use Highway to the Danger Zone to do this thing. I need somebody, it doesn't matter who, somebody to volunteer to pull up a music video just on a web browser to Highway to the Danger Zone and then just share that screen to this chat. Okay? And what I want to try to do is after you share that screen to the chat, I'm going to try to blow up that your window, put it over here on the shared screen for everybody. Then you're going to start the video and I want to see if A, everybody in the chat can hear the audio on that, which might mean you need to be coming from a Windows machine, which is probably most of you. And then I want to just see if it's showing up on YouTube so we can get blocked for copyright violation by playing 15 seconds of Highway to the Danger Zone.
Okay, I got it up.
Okay. Let's see. Where are we at here? Let's... you got a screen share on that?
Yeah.
Where are you? Oh, there we go. There we go. Okay. Michael right here. Yeah. Okay, so what I need to do now... Let me see. Hang on. I've got to pop this thing out. And then I'm going to take the popped out. You see it right here? Mm-hmm. And then we're going to go, that's you, this is me. All right. Is that, now make yours full screen, Michael.
Okay.
I think the, oops. Nope, that guy. The jiggy, there we go.
Is that full screen?
Yep.
Okay.
Ish, yeah. And then once, okay. This is a live experiment here, and this could resolve all of our video problems for the rest of the semester. Okay, and then we need somebody just checking on YouTube to see if this audio, if we do hear it here, if the audio goes out to YouTube. Okay, we're ready?
Yep.
I promise not to make any comments about you know who. Okay, let it rip, man.
Danger Zone.
Okay, can you crank that volume up a little bit?
Yeah.
Now, is that coming through external speakers, Michael? Or is that coming, like, internal, like the sound of the screen share?
I don't know. I'm only hearing it as if I'm watching the YouTube video on my end.
Okay. Because it's really faint from where I am.
I don't even hear it, to be honest.
I hear like crazy.
Just mute yourself and you'll be able to test that.
Oh, yeah, right. Michael, if you mute yourself, yeah, then we'll know if it's coming through your mic accidentally.
He's muted.
He's muted, and we're still getting sound. Okay, now let me try one other thing. This is Geek Power right here. I'm going to try to crank up the streaming on my side to see if I can max the volume out here. That's my max volume on the streaming audio feed. And he's maxed out, right? Okay, well, at least it's an existence proof of the concept, but we got to work on volume.
Is there a setting on Discord that has include system audio? Because I know on Microsoft Teams, there's a button that you have to click that says include system audio, so that you can hear whatever sounds are coming from the computer.
Yeah, if that exists, it's on Windows only, not Mac, or browser. It would be like Windows app. Ooh, and you're in a browser. Wait, no, that's the YouTube. I'm a dumb. Hang on. That's just Kenny Loggins in the browser.
I've got the Windows app.
What's that?
I've got the Windows, like, full-on application.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. And then is there a button for you, Michael, that says, what was it that you were saying? It on the Windows app that it includes?
Includes system audio.
Let me find my settings.
And I appreciate your patience on this. I know some of you watching YouTube going, yeah, come on, man, you're killing me. Or we could also come back and redo.
Oh, wait, I think I found a button. Okay, let me try it again. Is it louder?
Sounds the same to me. I wonder. Let me try one other thing. Okay. I mean, it'll make a difference later on when we're, you know, when we get to the part where we need to actually show some video stuff. That's why we're doing this. Plus, it's just such a great song. Okay. Yeah, I don't think there's anything on my side that I can do because I'm getting other audio voice that's coming in at kind of normal volume. So, okay, should we pause this and come back to the experiment later after we have a chance to toy around a little bit more?
Do it later.
All right. All right, hey, thank you for that. Thanks for the indulgence all around. That was actually super important to try to figure that out. So much, much appreciated. And then you can, like, you know, kill your screen share, Michael. Thanks for being the driver. Okay, where are we at here? Okay, just getting my configuration back into normality. On, where are we at here? Okay. All right. Okay, let's do the thing. Let's do it. Let me see. Where are we? Back to here. Bits and such. Okay. Let's rock and roll. I'd like to give a shout out to Meme Guy. I don't know who this guy is, but Meme Guy, he makes me happy, and he's like my soulmate here during the lockdown. We both survive the same way. Okay, we were talking about logical operations, right? I think we were. We're not talking about addition. We're talking about the individual operations on individual bits. Okay. Where it's a binary operation, we said, because it had two variables. The variables are 0 or 1, and the operation is going to yield a 0 or a 1, depending upon what the operation is, how you define it. And the way that we define it is with a truth table, which basically says, hang on a second. All right. And the truth table basically just says, look, this is the definition. If you give me a 0 and a 0, for example, where's my mouse? Where am I? I seem to have lost my cursor. There we go. So the idea behind a truth table is it's just like, you know, it's okay. Well, if you can define this basically any way you want, right? Yeah, everyone's got that idea. I mean, I could create a little function I call Jumar, and Jumar is defined as whatever. We just make it up so that 0 and 0 gives us something, and 0 and 1 gives us something else, and it's just this random collection, right? And we just call it Jumar, and it wouldn't matter. We can do anything we want in the truth table. It so happens that the ones that we're interested in have meaning to us, like and. It means something, right? When they're both on, we're on. Otherwise, we're off. That's what and means. Or, look, if either one is on, or even both, we're on. They have to both be off for it to be off, right? That's or. Exclusive or, which basically says, if one's on and the other's off, that's the one. That's when we're on. If they're both on, nope. They're both off, nope. Okay? So we have these operations like and, nand, which is basically an and with everything flipped. Oh, not, right? If it's a 0, it's a 1. If it's a 1, you get a 0. So there's not. These are like well-known logical operators, but you could create anything you wanted with circuitry, and we'll get to kind of how you do that, actually. Everybody cool with that? Is that kind of making sense? And let me see.
Devin, you got some audio coming through.
Oh, Devin. Let me see. Come on, Devin. So, Devin.
Something I did not mention earlier.
Hang on, I'm texting him.
I take each of these strands of fiber and then put them together to make a thicker cable. But the fiber optic cable is a lot thinner than wire.
I just texted Devin.
You can put, like if you have just a really tiny space, you can put more data in a fiber.
Should I mute him? Now, if I mute him, you still hear him, right? Just I don't.
The other nice thing.
it's one of the occupational hazards, right, of this whole thing. He went away. Okay, well, that's probably for the best. I mean, no offense. That came out wrong. That came out really wrong. It's not what I meant. Okay. So we talked about the and function, right? We did this one already, didn't we? Anybody? I think we did.
It was the last thing we talked about last time.
All right. Thanks for that acknowledgement. A little bit of acknowledgement on the audio or the chat or the text chat helps me to not be alone and be responsive. Okay. So, or we just talked about it, right? This is it. It's true when either variable is one. That's it. Very straightforward. If they're both true, also true. Because or just says either or, right? Either or both. As long as one is on, we're on. If they're both off, we're off. By the way, what happens if I do like, can I do 3 columns of these? What would happen? Anybody want to just... Maybe you know, or maybe you're just guessing.
Yeah, you can do 3 columns.
Yeah,
you can do 3 columns.
What happens?
As many as you want, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So what would happen?
As long as one of them equals 1, then you're still fine.
That's it, right?
That one, yeah.
I could create 3,000 columns, and all of them would be 1, except for the one column where everybody's 0. I wouldn't recommend a truth table with 3,000 columns, but I'm just saying, or just says. Look, they have to, you know, they have to, one of them has to be on for it to be on. So OR is a binary operator in the sense that it works between 2 bits, but it's also true that if I do these 2 bits and do like an OR on that, and then another bit, you know what I mean? Take the result of that, and that's still a binary operator. Is that making sense? What I mean is, I'm going to my whiteboard. because you love it so much. If I go 1 or 0 or 1, you know, I give you something like that. You're like, well, but Dr. K, you said it was a binary operator, which means it takes two variables, right? Well, yeah, but what I can do, for example, is I can evaluate that one, right, which gives me 1. And then I can evaluate this one, right, which gives me 1. So I'm still doing a series of binary operators. Does that make sense? It looks like I've got 3 variables there, and I do, but I'm actually doing it kind of like 2 at a time. So that's the sneaky Pete way of kind of rationalizing your way out of that. Now it turns out that XOR, not so clean. I mean, I can still do a series of XORs and bunch them together in 2s, you know. But OR is a little more intuitive. If I have 3 columns, it's a little more intuitive. Like AND, also very intuitive. If they're all on, we're on. If otherwise, it's off. Whether there's an OR, anybody's on, we're on. Otherwise, we're off. XOR is like 1 or the other, but not both. Well, how do you do that with 3s? You know what I mean? So that's one where you would have to think of it more as a series of binaries. Similarly with NOT. Doing NOT. NOT says, I'm just going to flip the bit. 3 columns, flip the bit. Okay, but my result would have to be 3 columns. You know what I mean? It doesn't make as much sense intuitively. All right? What about this? This is an interesting question that I want you to just think about. This is born out of a true experience. I was at HP. It was 1988. I was working on the original HP Vectra personal computer. I wasn't involved in the code on this one, but there's a part where the machine kind of boots up. And in the boot sequence, there's a part where you have to initialize memory. So when a computer comes alive, typically there's a little chunk of memory in some non-volatile memory that loads in. It's very, very small. And what it does is grabs the first sector off the hard disk, reads that in. It's called a boot sector. It reads that in. And then that boot sector just loads in and starts running and does things like loads the operating system and stuff like that. So that's what happens when you power down a machine and bring it back up. But there was a situation where during that initialization, when the machine comes alive, it would do this initialization. And there were all these errors. There were just like these random behaviors after you booted the machine up, right? And typically, as you know, if your computer's acting really weird, what do? You know, typically you power it down and you bring it back up, right? You're trying to clear everything, right? So what happened, I'll just give you the punchline, you know, what would happen if you initialized the computer by ORing? Well, let me just ask it this way. It turns out that the boot code did in fact come alive, the initialization code. It came up when you powered the machine on, and there's a bunch of value that has to be written into certain locations in memory, okay? And they were ORing that value into memory. Does that make sense? So I'd take this byte from what I'm trying to write, and I would go over here to memory, and I would OR it in. Take another byte, and I would OR it in. Another byte, OR it in. And it was mess. It was a mess. Why? Why was that a mess? And how would you do it differently? And it's okay if you're guessing. You know what I mean? If you don't know and you want to just take a stab, you know, we'll mock you just a little bit. Probably drop a meme in the chat.
Will it kind of mess everything up? I mean, in the long run?
The computer wouldn't work right. I mean, right. That was a big problem.
Because the values are changing?
What do you mean by that?
Like, I guess I don't know.
That's all right. That's all right.
I had an idea in my head and then it went away.
Okay. What are your ideas? And if you're too shy to say it out loud, you can drop it in the chat as well and I'll read it.
So instead of pouring it in, is there like a way to replace what's there with the new stuff? Or
because that's the goal, right, Stephanie? That's what we're really trying to do. But what happens if I've, let's just say that I have an area in memory and it's just all zeros, right? It's all zeroed out. And I take the values I want to write in there and I OR it in. Any problem?
No, that shouldn't be a problem.
Not a problem, right? Because anywhere I've got my memory that I'm trying to write in there, if there was a zero, that's all right. It goes zero or zero. If there's a one, zero or one, right? So whatever I've got that's going into memory survives the OR as long as everything's zeroed out.
But then once you have that new value written in and you go to put a different value in and it ORs.
And it turns out this was happening in the non-volatile memory, like the CMOS. There's some areas of the memory that were, that when you power it down, they don't clear out. You come back up. Same reason that you can boot it up and there's still code in there that will work. It's in non-volatile memory that's not dependent upon having the power on. Okay. So what happened was, you know, somebody said, you know, the values are changing. What's happening is as you're running the thing during the day or whatever, right, stuff's being written and going on there. Then you power the thing down, and when you boot it back up, there's stuff in there that has changed. And now when I OR it in, what if there's a one already in memory? And I take whatever it is I've got to bring it, and I have a zero over here that I'm trying to write into it. What's in memory?
One.
The one. The one wins. When you're ORing, one always wins. Right? And is different because they've got to kind of both be on. Right? So how would you do it? What would you do differently? We already talked about one. One is zero it out and then OR it in. Right? What would happen if you ANDed your values in? What happens?
I was thinking about AND. Because if you AND, then only if one is not true or one is off and one was on, then there's no way that both of them could be equal to each other. And so it would have to be one or the other.
Yeah, the challenge is you have to understand that whatever the operation is we do has to cause whatever I'm writing. So it's a little bit like taking a bunch of values here and a bunch of values here and doing some operation bitwise, right? Such that everything here gets obliterated and everything here survives and overwrites it. So what's the problem? If I've got a one over here that I'm trying to write into memory and memory currently has a zero,
then you would still get that. You'd get the zero.
Right? Because when you're doing ORs, one is the like the big bomb. One's the victor, right? One is the Hulk Hogan of the whole operation. When you're doing ORs, because it doesn't matter what else you got. You give me a one, you OR it, it's going to be a one. On ANDs, it doesn't matter what else you've got. You give me a zero, boom, blows everything up, right? So ANDing can't be the thing. So I don't even know off the top. I'm suddenly looking. I did a little example here just like on my little whiteboard pad. And I'm like blanking. I mean, obviously zeroing everything out and then ORing it in is a really clean way. If you did like XOR, what happens? The problem with XOR.
The same, then that...
Yeah, if they're the same, if I just I'm trying to bring a one in. And I mean,
that spot, it
then it's going to turn it to zero, and that's not what I wanted. So let's noodle more. I don't even know. I can't, honestly, I'm like totally blanking. I mean, as soon as we started the discussion. But I mean, clearly you can zero the memory out and OR it in. That's a clean way to go, right? I got to think more about that. I don't know why I'm blanking on that. Okay, but that's a true story. Now, that was all in development, so it's not like it shipped that way. You know what I mean? This was just a bug in development, but it was interesting that, you know, really good, talented, whatever, the problem was they made an assumption that the memory was zeros. And if that assumption was true, their approach was perfectly fine, but it wasn't. So you got to first start by clearing everything. Now, one way to clear everything is just to XOR it with itself. Right? Take this byte in memory, XOR it with itself. What happens? Any value
they're
XORed
both,
with itself.
They're both the same.
They're always the same. XOR says one of them is different. That's what XOR is. So if you XOR a value to itself, right? Whenever there's a 1, it's XORed with a 1. That's 0. If it's a 0 and a 0, you know, that's 0. And they're always the same because you're XORing it with itself. So anyway, yeah. But these are just true stories from the trenches. Okay, we talked about not. Very straightforward. It's a unary operator. It takes one variable. Okay? Are there any questions about not?
This, I have a question about the previous thing.
Yeah, Tom.
Is there a benefit to doing like the XORs versus just ending with zeros?
Yeah, right. Because the other way to clear memory is anding everything with zero, right? Take a zero and just go byte by byte, anding it with zero. Because in AND, zero blows everything up and turns everything to a zero. The only difference between those two operations, XORing everyone with itself versus anding everybody with zero, is going to come down to clock speed. And well, not clock speed per se. It relates. It's going to come down to the amount of cycles required for each one of those operations. And when you look at a specification for the hardware of a computer, it will tell you like how many cycles, like, and we'll get into what that means. We'll understand what that means by the time we're done. But it will actually tell you this many cycles or this many microseconds. There'll be a timing. And there's a time for performing an AND and a time for performing an XOR. I'll tell you this much, writing zeros into memory is horrible from a time perspective. It takes, well, and you'll understand that as well by the time we're done. Writing zeros into memory, bad. Okay, because it's just so expensive in terms of the number of cycles that the processor has to go through to write a value to memory, as opposed to, you know, XORing that value in memory. But again, it depends on the architecture. So I'm with Colby on the leaving and joining. Well, maybe they're having technical problems. I don't know. Oh, is there a way? Now, by the way,
Earlier on this morning, Discord, the live stream wasn't really loading for me. So that might be the same problem they're having.
Okay. Could be. Is this they help? Just, is there something that I can do to like turn off notifications that you won't hear?
Not to my knowledge.
I don't think so. Okay. Anyway. Yeah, man. Okay. Let's see. So, Morganator. So you can't see my screen. Everyone else can see my screen, right?
Yeah, I can see your screen. I was having the same issue just earlier in the stream where it wasn't loading. I'd like close it and then reopen it or something.
Okay, I think that's probably what we were hearing. So yeah.
Close and reopen or.
Is there a way to like kill those audio notifications though? Where, you know what I mean? Because I, you know, I'm kind of with Colby. I got.
It's pretty distracting, to be
honest.
Yeah,
it can't. Yeah, it absolutely can be.
Yeah.
Like that just there.
Yeah. Well, and the other thing too, okay, I just want to say, in defense of Colby and others, there's this thing called misophonia. You guys know what this is? Somebody give that a look up. I think that's how you spell it. I dropped it into the chat. And when you deal in the world of misophonia, certain kinds of sounds and stuff will just take you out. Depending upon, you know, varying degrees of the thing. But, yeah. Anyway, check it out. So, it might, I'm just saying that I deal with that at some level. And, you know, the misophonic nightmare. And some of you way, you know, are just way worse. Some of you is like, It's really no big deal. This little blunkety blunkety sound for me actually doesn't bother me. But there are other things that just like just make me insane, you know. So anyway, that's just a little bit of corroboration on the fact that you know what I mean? On the fact that this is a real issue for some people, and I experience it enough to really appreciate the struggle, okay, on that. So, okay, let's keep going. But yeah, if we can try to figure out how to, I don't even know, man. How do we mute that? There's got to be like a notification setting.
If it's in the settings, it'll be in the down arrow in the top left, and then in settings in there somewhere.
Yeah, maybe. Anyway, let's scout that. Maybe if somebody wants to just maybe do a little research on that, and maybe we can drop something in the chat. To help it everybody. Kind of,
in user settings, if you go to notifications and app settings, it looks like there's a notification that says user join and user leave. That might fix it. You can if you turn it off. I don't know.
Okay, that is. Does that change? Where are we?
I did that from my end, and it's working out just fine. But I'm hearing them from your end now, Dr. K.
Oh, from my end. Okay, so let me get those turned off.
I think.
Yeah, well, because I know that there's like a streaming mode.
Well, Dr. K, it says this was from June 4th of the year. It says open the notifications tab in the left. I'll just post it to the chat.
That'd be great. Yeah.
So I'm not explaining it, but yeah, I'll post that there and then see if that fixes it.
Well, and let me try. And I'm going to do one other thing, which is there is a thing in the settings called streamer mode. And if you click the enable streamer mode, there's default settings like disable sounds, disable notifications. And I just hit my enable streamer mode button there, which I had not done. And so let's see if that reduces it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that gets rid of your leaving and joining sounds.
Is that only mine? Yeah, because I was just thinking that for streamer mode, I was thinking might be more... impactful, because the idea would be if I'm streaming and people are watching, you don't want my stream interrupted with bloom, 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 right?
Exactly.
Because they're already here. They'd already be hearing it on their own. They're in the stream.
Yeah. Well, let's see if that, I don't know. Let's just try, but it's a good heads up, Colby. I'm glad you mentioned it. Because you know, this is all part of the fine tuning, right? So I don't know. Okay, let me just see one other thing real quick. I am streamer mode enabled. I'm still hearing them, but I don't know if they're coming through other people now or what.
Sounds, there's the... in the notification settings, user settings, notifications, you can turn them off in there, it looks like.
Okay, so where's the... Okay, so if I'm on...
Click the cog user settings.
Oh, there's notifications. Duh. Enable desktop notifications. Okay, let me turn that off. What else? Oh, sounds. Sounds. Okay, hang on a second. Let me...
Yeah. Then untick user join, leave, and then viewer join and leave.
Hang on. User leave is out. User moved. User join. Let me see. Outgoing and incoming ring. I don't need that, do I? Stream start.
No.
Viewer join, viewer leave. I'm just going ham here. I'm just taking them all out. Voice disconnected. Let's get rid of that. Mute and unmute. Okay, let's try that. Let's try that and see. I'm still hearing them. I don't know. Okay, let's roll for a while and see what happens.
Yeah.
I don't, you can hear them from other people's mics.
Is that coming through mics, you think?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. All right.
I think everyone's got to mute themselves. Otherwise, if one person isn't muted and then one person joins,
but how would that work if you were streaming though? Because you got to be able to, as a streamer, to limit, you know, the ambient sounds that your followers or viewers or chat people are, you know what I mean?
Well, I think you can change your settings so you don't get those notification sounds. But if someone else has them,
what is that?
Yeah, I think he's just messing with the settings.
Okay.
Sorry, let me mute myself. I apologize.
Yeah, so if someone else is unmuted, then the sound of someone joining or leaving is going to play through their computer, which is going to play through their mic, and everyone's going to hear it through them.
I think we're good right now if I disconnect real quick. Did you guys hear that?
I'm not hearing.
I didn't hear it either.
Yeah, I think we're good.
Okay. We'll keep trying. We'll refine it. Okay. Back to... The funny thing is, and probably just because I'm doing most of the talking, I had tuned it out. But understand that I often can't tune that kind of stuff out. You know what I mean? I'm the guy on the airplane that can't tune out the five conversations within three seats of me in every direction.
It's like loading back into the stream.
It's like a crazy feedback loop, and I can't shut it off. So I travel with earplugs and stuff. Okay, or... Yeah, we did that one. What else happens? Not. Okay, I know where we were. We were talking about not. And I was just saying, when you negate, when you have a number and it is in 2's complement representation, right? 2's complement notation. And remember, we flip all the bits and we add 1, right? In order to negate it, that's what we do, right? Everyone's cool with that. We got to get everybody, again, continue to get everybody cured from everybody goes raggy as soon as you say 2's complement, everyone starts flipping bits and adding 1 and stuff. It's like just negating. This is how you flip the bits. That's it. It's a bunch of not operations. Okay? That's it. Where are we? Yeah. So yeah, kind of the rhetorical question, why would you ever want to do this? It turns out, negating of number in 2's complement is an obvious one. And there are actually a lot of other operations where there's a reason why you want to negate. Sorry, where you want to not values, okay. Okay, we talked about XOR. Exclusive OR is its given name, but we call it XOR. And you got the idea, right? They got to be one or the other, but not both. That's what it says. One or the other, but not both. Every single one of these is just another little social contract. I don't know where my paper is. Everyone's a little social, little social contract. Every one of them essentially goes, oh, you said XOR? Oh, okay, I know what you mean by that. You mean that if they're both the same, I'm going to say 0, and if they're different, I'll say 1. That's all XOR says. So they're just little social contracts. Turns out we can build circuitry from transistors that actually do that. So if there's like power in this line, but not power in that line, it pops out with power. Or if they're power both coming in, no power out the other side. That's how we build circuits. And it functions just like these truth tables, which is actually really, really cool. I promise you. Yeah, we talked about XORing a number with itself. So that's the idea. That's this number, these two numbers XORed together, right? Whenever they were the same, you got a 0. Whenever they were different, you got a 1. Okay. So any questions about bitwise operators? Because we're done. I mean, we're not done with those. They're coming back. They're going to be here. But anything nagging? Anybody? I'm going to give Bueller like 5 seconds.
Anything nagging other than my wife? No, I'm good.
Ouch. There are a lot of nags in our lives. Okay, let's roll then. We're going to talk about other social contracts, okay? Other representations. Now, we're gonna pause for a second and talk about bit vectors, bitmaps. I have typically in my career seen these referred to as bitmaps or as bit masks, okay? And the hard part about this is just understand, remember when I said that you could kind of make a truth table that would do, you know, whatever you wanted? Well, it turns out that using these AND, OR, XOR, NOT, you know, using these operators, you can actually build certain kinds of, I don't know what you want to call them, like filters, let's call them, okay? And I'll try to see if I can get this concept to make a little more sense. In fact, I want to back up, because I think that, by the way, I did go make slides for the unsigned overflow. But I need to post the slides up to Canvas so you have access to those. But I did make some slides for unsigned overflow. Like I said, I would. But I realized that I want to, I just think this needs to be just a little better, okay? But here's a question. Imagine, actually, let me see. I want to go, I don't know, let me see. Imagine that I had a byte, 8 bits, okay? What have I got? 3, 6, 7, 8. Okay, there's my random, that's my random byte. And let's say that I used this byte to represent, I don't know, let's say I was representing a chessboard and I was just trying to indicate if there was like subnet mask works, Jack, except that it then brings in the whole data communications and internet. But imagine that I had a representation that I had like 8 bytes like this, and all it really told me was nobody on that piece, you know, nobody in that square. There's a piece in this square, a piece in this square, nobody in this square, nobody in this square, right? Or it could be maybe I have like this. I don't know, this auditorium, and the seats go, whatever, there's 32 seats across, or whatever the number of seats are, and I've got little sensors built into every seat that'll just tell me if the seat's occupied, right? So one approach is just to represent it like this, so that a 1 would mean that it's got somebody in it, and a 0 would mean that there's nobody in it, right? So as the thing starts going, all these bytes get populated with zeros and ones that just tell it, you know. Now, here becomes the question. That's not even good English. Imagine that you've got some little controller on the seat and it sends a message to the system that goes, hey, I got somebody in the seat, right? How do you just turn on one bit? Right? How do you turn on a single bit? Right? Because let's just say it's this one. Let's say it's this one right here. And somebody just comes in and it sits down and I need to turn on. We got to turn on that bit. How do you turn it on? Well, the answer is bit vector. Okay? So what happens is the little controller, hang on. The little controller has a byte with this value in it, okay? It's just 0001000000, okay? What can I do with this value? Just using only what you know so far, what can I do with this value to cause this value, everybody stays the same, but that one turns on? What can I do?
Or it.
Right? I can or it. I go, sorry, it's so hard to do this thing in like mirror image, right? But the oring goes, you know, no harm done, no harm done, right? You or a zero in, it just leaves whatever was there, right? If there was a zero, zero or zero is zero. If there was a one, zero or one is one, no harm done, right? So these zeros would leave it. But if I or a one, it doesn't matter what was in there, right? There it is. It doesn't matter what was in there. It's going to turn into a one because of the power of or. And then once again, ignore it, ignore it, ignore it, ignore it. And when you're, as soon as you do this operation, then this bit right there gets transformed by oring that value into here. So what I do is I create, we call it, it's like a bit, we call it a bit mask. Think about like if you've ever done painting and you do masking tape. What is masking tape for? You know, you paint on the masking tape, but then when you pull the masking tape off, it didn't go, it always does, but you know what I mean? It didn't actually go underneath the masking tape. Does that make sense? Well, it's the same idea. It's like I do, it's like I put masking tape on these three, and then I go masking tape on those five. I have too many bits. I'm a doofus. I'm a doof. Hang on a second. Let's get rid of that one, right? So it's like I put masking tape, then you leave that one there, then you go masking tape, then you put this like, it's like a paint sign. You put it over this guy, then you spray paint, and it like doesn't touch anywhere, but it does paint right there. Does that make sense? Is that a good example?
Yeah, that was a good analogy.
So that's why it's a mask. That's why we call it a bit mask. Because it's like masking tape. You know, if I, and I can do it the other way around as well. I can make it all ones. What if I wanted to clear it? I want to clear it. Right? What do I do to clear it? Anybody? Anybody? How would I clear it? I got to change the slides. My existing slides on this topic suck. That's why I'm doing this. I got to change them. Let me see. Okay. Oh, you know my problem? I just realized my problem is there are 9 bits in my original number because that's how big of a doofus I am. Okay, there we go. Everybody's now 8 bits. Okay, now I can't see because it's up too high. What about this value? What can I do with this bit mask if I want to clear only that bit? What would I do? What say you, my friends?
You'd use an and, right?
How would I use the and? Be more specific, please.
If you wanted to change the values, is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I want to turn that, like, let's say that I ordered that guy, this guy here, I ordered that guy because somebody sat in that seat.
Right.
Now they got up out of the seat and left. I want to clear it. What do I do with this mask in order to clear that back to zero?
Would you cover up the zero and clear all the ones?
Depending on what you meant, I don't know.
Okay. It was a try.
No, it's a good effort. What?
Maybe give someone else an idea.
Yeah, what? Somebody said and. Did you say and?
No, that was me.
Okay, Colby. Yeah, so and is the correct answer, but what do you do with the and? When you said use an and, okay, back home, I fed my dog some and.
Right.
I mean, what exactly are you talking about?
It's one and a zero, so the result would be false zero.
Yeah, you got to and these two numbers together.
Right.
Right? So you take the value that's there, you take this value, you and it, then what happens is when you're doing ands, right? The big explosion value for an and is a zero. That's the only thing that blows everything up. Same thing that with an or, the big blow up value is a one, right? Oring zeros doesn't change anything. Anding ones doesn't change anything. Because you think about it, where am I? You know, that guy there is going to stay zero because that zero wins. I'm totally disoriented here on my direction. Right? But that one and one is going to leave the one. So the one, basically, when you're anding, it just says, I'll leave whatever's already there. But boom, I go zero there. That's going to blow that guy up and make it a zero no matter what it was. So the idea is that you just create this bit pattern. So that particular seat, which we could call, you know, let's just say that this was seat number one, seat number two, number three, number four, and that's called seat number five, right? Could even be called like box seat number five, something like that. These maps right here, these bit masks, would be like the box seat number five setting, you know, to set, and this one would be the box seat number five to clear. When you apply these in that way, it fiddles only that one bit, which is kind of crazy, right? But really cool. It allows you to do really efficient things where if I'm only trying to tell whether something's sort of like there or not, then I only need a bit, right? I mean, that's what bits are, on or off, true or false, kind of there, not there, voltage, no voltage. So if I've got eight things and all I need to know is whether they're on or off or whether they're, you know, whatever they happen to be, seat, no seat, empty, full, stock, you know, stocking shelves, automatic sensors on something. All I can represent eight chairs in a single byte instead of like eight separate variables, one for each one. So I can just get a lot more efficient in use of space and certain kinds of operations. Okay. Now you might think that, well, seriously, Dr. K, surely in this day and age, right, we don't need to be that worried about a byte here and a byte there. Crap, you know, you got movie, you know, what, you download a movie, what in the heck, you know? I mean, you just an MP3 is a lot of bytes, right? You know, you're like, really? You're that worried? Turns out there's a couple reasons to be worried. One reason to be worried is there still are embedded systems, small systems that are very limited in terms of memory, and because it's also about battery life, you know what I mean? You get a tiny, tiny little thing, then battery becomes critical, and the more processing you have to do to tear the stuff apart, the more battery you burn, and the, you know, there's a lot of that kind of software that still is built, still in assembly language, and C. There is a crap ton of embedded software done in assembly language and C, still today in 2020. That's one reason. The other reason, though, is anything involving data communications. When you're dealing with data communications, that efficiency becomes a really critical thing. You can't just be, you know, if I can save, think about this from just like a bandwidth perspective, right? You're trying to watch Netflix, you're trying to do whatever you do that requires bandwidth. If I can take the data itself in the file, right, and represent it in a way that takes half as many bits to do it, I just doubled my throughput. That's twice as fast, right? Which is going to be that much more smooth, that much less kind of buffering, you know, the annoying, like, we're buffering, we're waiting, right? So that efficiency is still a really big thing. And the other one, and it actually relates to this slide, which is graphics. When you're on graphics and you start talking about a particular pixel in your, you might have, how many pixels are on a modern laptop?
Sorry to interrupt, but is the stream frozen for anybody else?
Yeah, it's frozen for me.
Yeah. What do we do?
Yeah, it's frozen.
Let me see something. Thanks for speaking up, Colby. I'm going to do something because it's not frozen out the other side, but what I'll do is relaunch a new windowed preview. And that should be...
There we go. We're good.
All right. That better for everybody?
Yeah.
Yep. All right. Thank you.
Yeah, it looks good.
Thank you.
All right. Yeah. Thanks for bringing that up. So where was I? I was saying...
amount of colors in the
right yeah
like
how many
it's like 15.6 million or something like that,
millions and millions and millions, yeah, lots of those little things. Well, once again, you're trying to do like smooth animation, right? You're trying to play a video game or show a video, or you know what I mean, you're trying to do stuff with high res video. You're once again, if I have to take twice as much effort, memory, you know, processing power, if, you know, just to like do a screen refresh, because you realize that the way you screen refresh is you change the value. Every pixel on your machine, what did you say, 15 million? Let's say on an average laptop. Every single one of those pixels is actually just a value. It's a number. It's an unsigned integer with some number of bytes, depending on the environment, that are just literally in a location in memory. And it's a memory mapped, usually it's a memory mapped IO, which we're gonna talk about, but it's a memory map. So to change the color of a certain pixel, I write a new value into memory at a certain location. And did anybody just go poof? Because that's actually how that works. Well, so every time I do animation, like this live stream that you're watching, right? Now there's a lot of intelligence too, right? Like all this stuff up here that's like kind of, you know what I mean? It's not changing much, you know, that stuff, right? But anything, so it'll do a lot more efficiency with not having to resend all of that information when it's the same information as what's sitting there. But every time, you know, I'm going like that, you know, it's having to go, okay, in that one spot right there, there's a pixel. And the color on that pixel has to change. When you do a screen refresh, you do that. To get smooth animation, 30 times a second typically is a minimum for smooth animation. So how much data do I have to handle if I've got 15 million pixels and every pixel is, I don't even know. I don't even know. 32 bits, 64 bits. I don't even know what normal... By the way, the more colors you've got, that has to do with how much memory you have for each pixel. If I gave you one byte per pixel, then your maximum number of colors would be 256 colors. No bueno. Back in the day, you had like 16-bit color, you know, and crap like that. But right, so now you've got, let's say it's 64. So that gives me, let me see, I got 16, 32, so it gives me 8 bytes to refresh times 15 million, you know, now we're up to about 100 million memory writes, 30 times a second to get smooth video. So what are we up to now? That's 3 billion? Yeah, yeah. We're into the neighborhood of 3 billion data reads and writes per, well, at least writes per second to give you, you know, the next season of Stranger Things or whatever, you know, so you can have Netflix. Right? Isn't that crazy? Isn't that crazy? Well, you start talking 30 billion memory touches per second. Efficiency becomes relevant. And if I can do it twice as fast, then I've got twice as smooth. You know what I mean? Or less bogged down on the rest of the system. Does that make sense? A little bit of insight, maybe, hopefully. Are you talking and I can't hear you?
No, yeah, that makes sense.
Nope, I got you. Okay.
Be good.
Am I frozen again? Why did...
I'm doing fine on my end.
Okay. Oh, maybe that was an older message from Jay about rebooting. Okay. Yeah, yeah. But anyway, All right, but you get the idea that, in other words, even though we live in a world with terabyte hard drives and, you know what I mean, crazy fast processors and quad processors, you know, 2, 4, 8, you know, these crazy powerful machines, even though we live with that, you still need to monkey around with efficiency and speed. There are just situations. So this example here of the Bitfactor is really just kind of an idea of the same idea. You can do, you know, I could encode like in a what they call RGB, red, green, blue, right? Which is one of the technologies for monitors, right? There's a red dot, a blue dot, and a green dot. They're very, very close together. And you turn one of them on, one or anywhere from none to all of them on. And this is the pattern you get. If the color is going to be black, then they're all off. If it's going to be, you know, yellow, you got to hit the red and the green, right? Now, this is just traditional, what they call RGB. And you're doing this with 3 bits. You're manipulating the whole thing, starting with the primary colors as only a single bit. And then you can combine those. And this is, by the way, this is C. This is in C. So this is an OR, red or green, red or blue. And this is ORing that value together in a bitwise OR, okay? This is super rudimentary, but the concept's the same. And then when you get, you know, if this like really lights you up, then maybe this is your area. You know, maybe you need to think of, you know, but if you get into, you want to get heavy into graphics, this is the kind of crap you have to deal with, okay? And, you know, you go heavy into data communications, a different variety from this, but it's the same kind of crap. Okay, and then this was the one that is really kind of an example like I did with people sitting in chairs. This is a similar idea, so I'm going to just skip past that since we kind of already hit it. And that's kind of turning on and off. But I like the seats and chairs example better than machines on or off. I think it's better. Okay, now I want to just say one last thing. Going back to right here, you do see these terms. And I throw them out mostly. I'm not going to expect you to like, you know, memorize these different terms. But just know that I have heard bitmap. And again, I think that has to do with like, I'm mapping to certain bits. Maybe that's the intuition. Bit array kind of makes sense if you think of it as an array data structure, right? Where there's just a 1 or a 0 in each spot. That kind of makes some sense. Bit field. Okay. You know, and then again, my personal favorite is bit mask. I always call it a bit mask when I'm specifically trying to like see certain bits and ignore all the others. Okay. Also, I might need to read. By the way, we did that with like writing. But what if I were just trying to read the value? I got all these bits coming in here. I only care about this one. Right? Well, I can put that mask down, clear all the others. And then I just have to ask myself, think about this for a second. If I'm trying to look at a particular bit, and I create a bit mask. Let's just go, the bit mask means that those guys are going to go away and they're going to go away. All I have to check now to see if that bit is on is whether the result is like zero or non-zero. See what I mean? I turned all the others off. That's the guy still there. If he was off, the value is zero. Otherwise, he was on. So the logic becomes really simple. Does that make sense? So I'm not just writing values like I'm turning it on and I'm turning it off, but I'm also like reading the value and trying to figure out, is there somebody in that seat? I want to start I don't know what I'm doing with the seat, maintenance on the seat. I want to make sure no one's sitting in it when I start maintenance, whatever. I read it, I mask all the others off, and and that just gives me an entire value that's either zero or not zero. That's crazy handy. Everybody good with that? Okay. How we doing? Oh, I want to just talk about, we got just a minute. I only want to spend a minute on floating point. Now, social contract again. All we're doing is saying, how are we going to, how do we want to represent this thing? What do you do with floating point numbers? These are the ones that look like, you know, 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd, or, you know, times 10 to the negative 23rd, which would be 0.00000, a lot of O's. That's me doing a lot of O's. 6023. It's a very, you know, really fine fraction, right? How do you do fractions? Well, this, by the way, is not going to be on any of the homework or the exams. To me, it's just advanced enough of an idea that, look, our world of math and binary is all going to be integers. For this class, for 2810, everything's integers. But if you start doing underneath, you got to have floating point processing, or you can't do like division, you know, reasonable division. You know what I mean? So what you do, and this is just, it's not the only way to do it, but here's one way to represent floating point or fractions. One is there's a sign bit, okay? Then you allow 8 bits for an exponent. That's like the 23, 8 bits. So what's big? What's the biggest power I can have? And by the way, this exponent is a, I think it has to be a 2's complement number. Okay? That 8 bits has to be a 2's complement number on the exponent. Because I can have negative exponents or positive exponents. That all has to do with, is the decimal point going that way or is it going that way? That's the reason for that. This is the overall sign of the, that sign right there is the overall sign of the number. Like, negative 6.023 times 10 to the 23rd, or negative 6.023 times 10 to the negative 23rd, there's still an overall sign. The sign on the exponent just says, is it 0.00000 and then you get to it, or is it 6023 and a bunch of zeros before you get to the decimal point? Does that make sense? So I could say 8 bits for the exponent, and then I can go 23 bits for the fraction, which is like the 6023 part, which is not represented with a decimal point. It would be 6023. So I could have an exponent as big as 255, positive 255, or negative 250. No, sorry. Positive 127, negative 128, 2's complement number. And I've got a fraction, which is unsigned, and I've got 2 to the 23rd, which happens to be in the neighborhood of 8 million. So I can put a number as big as 8 million. I can make it a positive or a negative, and I can have that 8 million, that level of granularity, right? Which would be, what is that, 7 digits, right? So I could have a 7-digit number times 10 to up to 127-ish, you know, plus or minus. I could represent that. This is kind of crazy if you think about it. I could represent that in just 4 bytes. Does that kind of blow anybody's head just a little bit? That's a lot of fractions that I can represent in only 4 bytes. Everybody's buying, right? What if I decided, yeah, what if I decided I wanted more on the exponent? Not 8, I wanted 9, right? Then I'd be down to 22 over here. Or what if I wanted 6 and then I could have 24? I mean, it's a trade-off. It's a trade-off. What if I wanted to have, instead of 32-bit floating point, what if I wanted to have 64-bit floating point? I get more precision, right? Remember discretization? I take these continuous numbers and I have to chop them up because we just are limited by the hardware. Well, the more data I've got, the finer the chop, which means the more precision I can get to, but it's never perfectly precise. It's always a compromise when I take a discrete value. Floating point are always discrete values at the end of the day because they're represented in hardware with a certain number of bits, and that's it. And when you run out of precision, you run out of precision. Okay? Last thing that I'll just say, and then we need to cut loose. Python. A lot of you guys did Python. How big is an integer in Python? How big is a number? How many bytes is a number in Python? Does anybody just know off the top of your head? In C, it's machine dependent. Typically 16 bits for like an unsigned integer or some kind of a, you know? We just said 32 bits for a floating point number. What's the amount of representational stuff that you can use for Python? Which is
It expand? Like just a count, it naturally translates to however many it needs in Python?
Yep. So what's the that's absolutely right. So what's the answer? I'll give you the clever, pithy response. The value, the size of a value, whether it's floating point, you know, a real number or an integer, in Python is how much disk space do you have? And guess what? If you're trying to do data science, massive data, big data, you're trying to do, you know, astronomy, and you're trying to do, you know, just big math, right? You can literally have a single value, and it's like a gig of memory for that one value, because you've got that much precision. And even then, you run out. But beats the crap out of 32 bits to do it, right? The more, isn't that amazing? That's amazing that Python does that. And that's why it is so desirable for data science. If you were trying to do this kind of crap with C, you'd be like, oop, I just lost precision. You know, my value needed to be 0.00000001, but C just goes, zero. I can't even get out that far. So, does that make sense? So man, Python in that respect is amazing. That's an amazing feature for a language. That blows me away. I wanted you to have an exposure to floating point. You know what I mean? So you understood that thing, and then we're done with that. I'm not gonna put it on homework. I'm not gonna put it on the module exams. I think there's enough like brain twisting going on already with just everything we're trying to get you to. 2810, it's just one of those classes that just drags you through paradigm shift after paradigm shift after paradigm shift. You know what I mean? There's so many. We're going to go transistors and circuits and hardware and low-level stuff, the machine language and instructions and assembly language. And we're going to give you so many concepts that I just felt like this is not one we have to throw in. And by the time you're out of the program, you'll touch it, but you'll at least have an exposure. That's kind of what I'm going for. Okay, we're over time. And so I'm going to hang tight for a little while. We should have Vlad on at 3. So anyway, I'll be around if you want to hit me up with any questions, but I'm going to go ahead and stop the stream right now. See you all on Thursday. Oh, and Thursday, we will wrap this up. This is module 3. It's the second half of chapter 2, but it's module 3. You've got to be working on the module 3 homework while we're doing this in class. If you're watching it on YouTube or whatever, pause. Go do the homework for that part. You know what I mean? Help yourself out. And we will absolutely finish module 3 on Thursday, and we'll jump into module 4. It's starting to accelerate, a little acceleration. Okay, everybody, take care. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Please, I beg you, stay healthy. Hubert and I feel urgent about your physical and emotional health.
Thank you, Dr. K. Thank you, Hubert.
Hubert is my emotional support plaid monkey. And I'm not even kidding about that. There's a reason he lives right here, okay? Hubert and I say, take care of yourselves. Okay. All right. Good luck. See ya.